On August 14, 3276, the sun will not rise anywhere on the planet Earth. It sounds like complete nonsense, but it is impossible to refute this statement without living until the corresponding date. Throughout our lives, every morning the sun rises in the east and every night it sets in the west. Judging by numerous historical sources, the sun has behaved in this way for millennia. And what do? We conclude that this will always be the case. That is, from a certain number of observations, we derive a general rule. But do we have any basis for this? How reliable is such a rule? This is the so-called problem of induction. Mathematician and logician Bertrand Russell, in his work, The Problems of Philosophy, writes about a chicken whose owner daily fed it millet from birth. The chicken grew, lived, and made conclusions. It extended or extrapolated the results of its daily observations into a theory about a kind master. And every time the chicken was fed, its theory gained more evidence. But one beautiful day, the owner came with an axe and cut off the chicken's head, thereby refuting its inductive theory. I repeat, it's inductive because the chicken made a general conclusion based on a certain number of observations. You might say, the chicken's theory was superficial, and it did not have the whole picture. It simply lacked an understanding of what humans call livestock farming, so the chicken merely had a false conception of cause and effect relationships. But why do we suddenly think that humans have the true conception, cause and effect? Does the latter always follow the former? Do we ever see the whole picture ourselves? And does such a picture even exist? When you started this video, you probably had vague doubts of the sort. What? Will tomorrow come? How can tomorrow not happen? Are we threatened by some catastrophe, a meteor strike, or a nearby supernova explosion? Well, as far as I know, no, none of the above threatens us. And yet the fears are quite justified, because I'm talking about more global things than a pitiful heap of cosmic rock or even the explosion of a gigantic star. The reason why tomorrow might suddenly not happen may well be related to how the universe likely came into being. We are so convinced of the correctness of personal experience that as soon as the special theory of relativity was published, there were cries everywhere claiming that the theory spawns a multitude of paradoxes. Opponents of the theory offered various thought experiments to support their claims. The special theory of relativity tells us that for a stationary observer, the length of moving objects contracts in the direction of their movement. Imagine a 10-meter stick and a 5-meter hanger. Based on the principles of the special theory of relativity, if the stick moves fast enough, at a speed close to the speed of light, the length of the stick will decrease to the extent that as the stick flies through the hanger, it can fit inside it entirely. However, the theory of relativity is named as such not because it sounds nice. From the stick's perspective, it is stationary, and it's the hanger that's moving towards it at an incredible speed. Thus, the hanger should reduce in size, such that the stick won't be able to fit inside at all. This is the essence of the paradox, as the stick can't both fit and not fit inside the hanger simultaneously. People proposing their so-called debunking thought experiments took into account some effects of the special theory of relativity, but ignored others. Yet Einstein's theory is mathematically consistent. Yes, in the example with the stick and the hanger, there is actually no paradox. Everything will be just as described. From the perspective of the hanger, the stick will fit inside it completely. But simultaneously, from the perspective of the stick, the hanger will seem too small for it. This happens due to the relativity of simultaneity. Events that are simultaneous for one observer in his frame of reference might not be simultaneous for another observer in a different frame of reference. The question of whether the stick fits in the hanger must be considered from the perspective of each observer, both the stick and the hanger, separately. If we are in the hanger's frame of reference, there exists a moment when both ends of the stick will simultaneously be inside the hanger. However, if we are in the stick's frame of reference, there isn't a moment when both ends of the stick will simultaneously be inside the hanger. You might ask, then whose viewpoint is correct? The answer, both are. Yes, objectively simultaneous events in one frame of reference will not be simultaneous in another. It sounds completely absurd, but it has been verified by experiments, a scientific fact. And these experiments were by no means merely conceptual. Moreover, for different frames of reference, events can not only occur non-simultaneously, but even in different sequences. Doesn't this challenge our understanding of the concept of cause and effect? In reality, it doesn't. But can you unequivocally and confidently claim that a connection exists? For instance, between me dropping a pencil and it falling to the ground. Establishing causal relationships is a profound characteristic of the psyche of living beings and not necessarily of the objective world. Burr's Frederick Skinner conducted a series of fascinating experiments. He designed special individual cages for pigeons. In each cage, there was a button positioned in such a way that the likelihood of it being pressed accidentally was low, but if pressed, the pigeon in the cage received a small amount of food. After a few accidental presses and food rewards, pigeons quickly grasped the pattern and established a cause and effect relationship between pressing the button and getting food. But the most intriguing part of the experiment began when the scientists set up the devices to dispense food randomly. Essentially, all the pigeons had to do was sit and wait. Food was delivered to the cage at certain intervals, regardless of the pigeons' actions. However, such chaos didn't sit well with the birds. They began to associate food delivery with completely unrelated behaviors. For instance, if a pigeon was standing with its neck stretched to one of the upper corners of the cage when food was delivered, from its perspective, that very action caused the food to be dispensed. The bird would repeatedly perform this motion, becoming more and more convinced it worked with every subsequent reward. The pigeons developed distinct rituals. Some birds made rocking motions as if ducking their heads under an invisible barrier, and then lifting them up. Some performed pendulum-like movements with their heads and bodies. Some lowered and raised their heads, and so on. The mechanism of establishing cause and effect relationships is a very useful one. It aids in survival and is inherent in all highly organized beings. But isn't it the same mechanism that compels us to see meaning in talismans or to avoid labeling the 13th floor as the 13th? After all, what connection exists between a trinket around the neck and success in life, or between numbers and misfortune? The same mechanism makes us believe that if a pencil falls down 1,000 times, it will fall again on the 1,001st time. But is that really the case? The English philosopher David Hume aptly demonstrated that the very concept of cause and effect relationships is abstract and exists only in our minds. For instance, we have the objective world around us, and there's the realm of human psyche, our inner world. In the objective world, outside of us, there might be certain objects, like a brick and shattered glass. In our inner world exist impressions, potentially caused by these objects. That is, information from our sensory organs. This information might evoke ideas and images in our mind. David Hume argues that we cannot be certain whether the brick truly caused the image of the brick in our mind, or if the sound of shattered glass truly conjured its image in our thoughts. Similarly, we cannot determine with 100% accuracy the cause and effect relationship between a potential brick and potentially shattered glass. However, we are certain that one impression cannot be the cause of another. The connection between impressions and the resulting images in our minds is unquestionable. Impressions are causes, and ideas are their effects. In the same way, some ideas can cause other ideas. Yet, based on the experience of seeing a brick, it might evoke a mental image of shattered glass in us, and vice versa. Hearing the sound of breaking glass might evoke an image of a brick in our minds. But we can never be certain if there's a connection between the brick and shattered glass outside our cognition, in the objective world. We observe that one event always follows another and conclude that there's a connection between them. If we want to verify the true presence of this relationship, we ask about the connection between phenomenon A, say the strikes of a hammer, and phenomenon B, for instance, the nailed nail. What is the relationship between hammer strikes and the nail being driven in? This question might seem trivial at first glance. We can say that we simply hit the nail with the hammer, thus driving it in. Both the hammer and nail are solid, so they repel each other upon contact. But what does solid mean, and what's the connection between solidity and repulsion? Bodies are composed of tiny particles, atoms. Solidity is a state of matter with a specific arrangement of these atoms. Solid objects repel because the nuclei of atoms are surrounded by a shell of electrons in their orbit. When atoms come close to each other, their electrons prevent them from touching and repel each other. So, we deduce that strictly speaking, the hammer and nail never really touch each other. But what's the relationship between the presence of electrons and their repulsion? Well, electrons have the same charge, and like charges repel. Okay, I get it. But what's the connection between having the same charges and them repelling each other? Eventually, the answer to the question, what's the connection, will be, we don't know. and our ignorance is fundamental. We fundamentally cannot detect a cause and effect relationship. It's an abstract concept. No answer, demonstration, or experiment will let us see how one event can cause another. It's impossible to bridge this knowledge gap, meaning it's also impossible to see how event A can cause event B. We always only observe a sequence of events, but never the connection between them. Yes, hammer strikes drive in nails. No one will argue with that, but we don't know why. At a superficial level, we talk about cause and effect relationships, but on a deeper level, we refer to correlation. Correlation is a relationship between two or more events, but this relationship is not causal, it's statistical. At the foundational level, there's no causal relationship between hammer strikes and driven nails, but there's a strong correlation. One of the most prominent philosophers of the 20th century, Ludwig Wittgenstein, writes in his logical philosophical treatise, "The process of induction consists in acknowledging the truth of the simplest rule that coincides with our experience. This process, however, has no logical foundation, but only a psychological one. Clearly, there's no reason to assume that the simplest will actually occur. The hypothesis that the sun will rise tomorrow means that we don't know if it will." If you find it puzzling how an educated adult with a sound mind could ponder on such a matter, black swans come to his defense. For most of human history, the term black swan was an oxymoron like hot snow, original copy, or tiny giant. Up until the 17th century, people had only observed white swans, and from this, they deduced the non-existence of black ones. However, in 1697, Dutch explorer William de Vlaming in Australia witnessed the non-existent black swan with his own eyes. Human thinking is poorly organized and unsystematic. We constantly perceive universal truths in specifics, which leads us to frequent errors. In attempts to somehow organize external and internal chaos, we gradually develop the scientific method. Today, one of the primary criteria for scientificity is the principle of falsifiability, introduced by Karl Popper, who also believed that all scientific hypotheses should be regarded as conjectures, not true theories, because through experience, we can only judge the falsehood of a statement, never its truth. 100,000, 1,000,000, or even 100,000,000 observed white swans do not allow us to conclude that all swans are white, whereas just one black swan refutes this claim. All our theories strictly fall into two categories: those already disproven and those not yet disproven. Thus, the phrase "science has proven" is quite crude. Science offers models of reality and endlessly tests them, conducting increasingly accurate experiments. But as we've understood, there can never be enough checks. Indeed, the absence of confirmation of a theory's falsehood does not confirm its truth. Like the chick in the earlier example, we never truly know if we see the whole picture. Therefore, science doesn't really prove, but rather reduces uncertainty. Statistically, on August 14, 3276, it is quite likely that the sun will rise. Statistically, hammer blows will drive nails, but the likelihood of either event cannot be 100%. You might ask, is everything upon which the foundation of human knowledge is built just correlations? Some scientists, for instance, believe that human knowledge primarily rests on deep explanatory theories, which are subsequently confirmed or refuted by observations. Now, in the 21st century, we don't think the sun will rise tomorrow just because it rose yesterday. We have the general theory of relativity, which not only predicts sunrises and sunsets, but also explains why they occur. This sounds uplifting, but you'll quickly notice that the same issue applies to the laws of physics. We believe they will continue to work in the future based solely on the fact that they worked in the past. This is the same inductive approach. One could say, relax, the laws of physics are unbreakable. The patterns of the world known to us aren't going anywhere. They are stable and immutable. There's no problem with induction. People just made it up. But here we approach one of the greatest mysteries of modern physics. I can take the last three sheets of the script for this video and tear them to pieces, but will I destroy the information written on them? No, because the sheets can be pieced together and read for their content. But what if I burn them? That still won't get rid of the information, because given unlimited computational power, we could analyze the ashes, smoke, and thermal radiation to retrieve the lost information. A fundamental principle of classical quantum physics is that we cannot irretrievably destroy information, because the state of any system at any point in time is determined by its value at any other moment, past or future. Our entire faith in scientific determinism is based on this premise, which means that the universe evolves in accordance with the laws of physics. And these laws tell us that black holes exist. So, would I be destroying information if I sent it into a black hole? Black holes are the simplest objects in the universe. Uncharged and non-rotating black holes are described by just one parameter, mass. Two uncharged and non-rotating black holes of the same mass are fundamentally indistinguishable from each other. This means that compressing 100 pounds of iron and 100 pounds of turtles would yield two absolutely identical black holes. Do you see? Two absolutely identical objects, obtained from two sets of materials with very different configurations. And one might argue, what's the difference? What happens in a black hole stays in a black hole. But then Stephen Hawking enters with his calculations, asserting that black holes actually slowly evaporate, losing mass and eventually disappearing. This phenomenon was named Hawking radiation. This radiation is unrelated to what entered the hole. We witness a fundamental destruction of information. And this conundrum is known as the black hole information paradox. Some might argue it's just another fabricated issue. But hold on, many scientists believe this to be the central problem of science. In his book, Short Answers to Big Questions, Stephen Hawking writes, "A significant portion of scientists believe that information should not vanish, but for many years, no one has proposed a mechanism by which it could be preserved." This paradox presents a grave issue, which touches the very foundations of our understanding of science. If information in black holes truly vanishes, we won't be able to predict the future since black holes could emit any set of particles. It may seem trivial, since we don't have black holes nearby, but it's a matter of principle. There might exist black holes that arise as fluctuations from vacuum, absorb one set of particles, emit another, and dissolve back into the vacuum. After all, if the predictability of the universe ceases in black holes, it might cease in other scenarios too. If predictability stops working in black holes, then the problem of induction is a paramount issue that we might never solve. Some of our theories suggest that the universe could emerge from nothing and for no apparent reason. Given what's been said, this perspective on the origin of the universe gains more meaning. Effects don't necessarily follow causes, and causes might not need to exist at all. If the universe spontaneously emerged from nothing, then why couldn't it spontaneously revert to nothing? I would greatly appreciate it if you left a comment and rated this video. Thank you for watching.